All right, welcome to chapter 4, immune. There's 40 some medications here, so I just wrote it up. I put one group out of order. My hand cramped in writing all of this, so I'll just tell you which one's out of order, but we'll get to that in a bit. So the first thing I want to do is I want to start with four OTC medications. Okay. OTC. Okay. Neomycin, polymyxin B, and bacitracin. This mycin stem you may have seen before. It just means that it's from the Streptomyces bacteria, but it doesn't necessarily tell you that it's exactly an antibacterial. But neomycin, polymyxin B, bacitracin, this is Neosporin. So what we're going to do is we're going to go through antibacterials, antifungals, antivirals with these four medications in that order. And then through the big list, we're also going to go antibacterial, antifungal, antivirals. Okay. So the antifungal over the counter, so you might know Lotrimin Ultra. We use for athlete's foot, things like that. It's butenophene. Okay. Then influenza vaccine, so again using the prophylactic, something that's trying to prevent infection. Before we use something acute, Dicasinol. So influenza vaccine has one of its brand names as Fluzone. And when you see flu in a brand name, that means influenza. But if you see flu in the generic name, except for obviously the word influenza, like fluoxetine, Prozac, or another one's escaping me now, but that means a fluorine atom. So be careful about using flu to mean for the flu or for influenza. Dicasinol, it's a Breva. I had no idea why anybody paid $20 for this, but it'll make your cold sore go away much faster. But think about Dicasinol so you can go to the ball or you can go to the prom. That's, I guess, why you would spend $20 on something like that. But it abbreviates the amount of time that that cold sore lasts, so a Breva. Let's start with the first antibiotic or antibacterial section. So I had a little piece of tape here on the board, so we put penicillin over here. But we have one penicillin antibiotic, but something unusual about it. We start with amoxicillin, which is amoxil, and this has the cillin stem. Okay. And so amoxicillin, penicillin, methicillin, these are all penicillin antibiotics. We see that from the stem. But amoxil is the brand name. You just took out the IC and then the LIN. But what's this clavulanate? So sometimes the bacteria can secrete an enzyme which can make the antibiotic ineffective. That beta-lactamase enzyme can destroy the amoxicillin. But if you add this clavulanate, you can augment, and you see that word augment in augmentin, the brand name, this amoxicillin. The cephalosporins are related to the penicillins. They work on cell walls as well. So I'm not going to get too much into mechanism of action. That's all in the book. This is just review. The archaic one was CEPH, and I think they got rid of this because ceph means brain or head, if you're talking about medical terminology, and its brand name is Keflex. But this is first generation. What that means is that a first generation drug has three properties that a third or fourth generation wouldn't, or the other way around, third and fourth have properties that first wouldn't. So a third and fourth generation would increase gram-negative coverage, would increase the ability to prevent beta-lactamase attack, just like the clavulanate does with the amoxicillin, ceftriaxone and cefepime. A third generation and fourth generation drug both do the same thing. And then these two have better penetration into the cerebrospinal fluid if we have some kind of infection there. Okay. But again, the stem is cef, C-E-F. Okay. So the importance with putting vancomycin here when it doesn't seem to relate at all is that vancomycin also affects the cell wall. This mycin stem, again, isn't really going to help you too much, but vancomycin is a glycopeptide, and it works a little bit differently against methicillin-resistant staph aureus, something like that. Okay. But these are all grouped together. Okay. This is where I kind of mixed it up. The tetracyclines should be before the macrolides. But you can see tetracyclines, doxycycline from the C-Y-C-L-I-N-E, and minocycline from C-Y-C-L-I-N-E. The reason they're called tetracyclines is because they have four rings. So the game Tetris was actually the tetra for four, and tennis. So the person who invented it just combined those two together. So we're just naming this class after the four rings in it. And then Dorix for doxycycline is the brand name, and then minocycline's brand name is Minocin. Then we have the macrolides. That macro comes from just being a big molecule. That's why they're named that way. This is an interesting one where we see the mycin, but we also see something very similar in the middle, the THRO. And this might be an infix, I'm not exactly sure, but thromycin, you see that they all have that, and that's one way to think that these three are macrolides. Now, do all macrolides have thromycin? No, but this is a little bit helpful. Okay? So azithromycin is a Z-pack. The way that I order it is that you only take that one once daily. Clarithromycin, you take it twice daily, so once daily, then twice daily, so biaxin, twice daily. And then erythromycin is taken four times daily. So the way that I put this in was to put it in number of doses a patient would have to take per day, 1, 2, and 4. Okay. All right. So we're actually continuing on to the next with some other antibiotics, clindamycin, which is cleacin. You see this used a lot topically because it can cause some severe side effects, severe diarrhea. So clindamycin a lot of times we'll see used for penicillin allergic patients in dentistry. The oxazolidinone, linezolid, and you can kind of see the classification in the name. The zolid stem, again, here puts it in that class. But Zyvox is very solid or zolid against MRSA and vancomycin-resistant enterococci. Amikacin and gentamicin both have those, the casein and mycin stems tell you, the mycin doesn't tell you it's an aminoglycoside, but these two are related in that way, so amikin and garamycin. The two dihydrofolate reductase inhibitors, so sulfa and prim are both a prefix, sulfa, so it lets you know it's a sulfa medication, and trimethoprim, the prim lets you know that it's a dihydrofolate reductase inhibitor. What does that mean? Well, bacteria need folic acid just like we do, but they have to make their own. So if you block them from making their own, it would kill the bacteria or hurt the bacteria. And then if you take a couple letters out of the word bacterium, you get Bactrim, the brand name. This fluoroquinolone is interesting because of the oxacin suffix. So the oxacin is the suffix, and then this FL is an infix. And this fluorine atom makes it a fluoroquinolone rather than just a quinolone. And then cipro, you just cut off the floxacin to make cipro from ciprofloxacin. And then levoquin is, you know, like levoquin, except it's a quinolone, so the quin for that. Antiprotozole, metronidazole, so nidazole is the stem. And it's an imidazole antibiotic, so you could see those letters kind of similar together. And this is flagyl. TB, I use R-I-P-E as the acronym or way to remember it. When you think of that raised section that if you would have a positive induration on a TB test, I would think it's ripe, like it's a welt or swelling. So rifampin, rifidin, isoniazid, INH, pyrazinamide, PZA, and ethambutol, which is my ambutol. And there's clues in there that I mentioned in the book about how to remember what the side effects are for those. But again, we're still in the antibacterials and with all of these medications, and now we're going to move over to the antifungals. So three antifungals. A lot of times, students will try to be very efficient, and they'll just try to remember the generic name. But amphotericin B doesn't really tell you much about what it does. But fungazone certainly tells you it's for fungus. Fluconazole, the conazole stem, some people get this wrong and they put that azole stem in there. And azole is just azole, it's just an organic chemistry group. So you don't want to use azole because if you do that, then you say fluconazole and omeprazole, a proton pump inhibitor, are in the same class, and that's just not true. Nystatin, so this is mycostatin. So if you had if you've had microbiology class, you know the myco means some kind of fungus. Okay. Be careful with this statin. So the statin and nystatin and the statin and mycostatin, there's a class of HMG-CoA reductase inhibitors that are anti-cholesterol medications that have this statin stem. And really the V-A-S-T-A-T-I-N is a better way to do that. And I'll talk about that when we get to cardio. Oseltamivir, so the amivir is the stem here. Make sure I use green. Okay. All right. And these brand names are great. They tell you exactly what it's for. Oseltamivir, you tame the flu, which is influenza. And zanamivir is Relenza, make the influenza relent. So pretty good brand names there. Another antivirals for herpes simplex virus and varicella zoster virus. Acyclovir, okay, so the cyclovir is the stem. And this, again, I didn't mention this vir stem, but it's kind of a substem. So vir is the all-encompassing antiviral stem. But amivir tells you it's for the influenza. Cyclovir tells you it's for HSV, ZV. And we have Zovirax, so zoster virus, Ax, the zoster virus, or Rec, the virus. So some you can see the Val from Valtrex and Val from Valacyclovir are similar. So some similarities there. I go over it all in the book. Palivizumab, so again, we have a monoclonal antibody, MAB, and this is for respiratory syncytial virus. So we've had a medication that's a biologic with this kind of naming for asthma, for ulcerative colitis, and as an antiviral. So this MAB doesn't tell you what it's for, but the Visu with the MAB helps you understand how it's working within the body. And then this is Synagis. Okay. Right. So those are the antifungals and then the non-HIV antivirals. The next thing I'm going to do is go over the HIV antivirals, which, so I haven't mentioned the top 200. There's going to be 200 drugs in this list. The top 200 drugs tend to omit the HIV medications, but I think it's essential that we talk about them and certainly how HIV works in the body. So let's go to the HIV medicines. Okay. A little dirty there. Okay. All right. So what I did was I put them in an order that makes sense in terms of how the HIV virus attacks the body. So the first thing the HIV virus tries to do, it tries to fuse. So we've got enfuvirtide, okay, and you can see the FU from fuse, but the vir stem, oops, wanted green, the vir stem and then the fusion, so something that's trying to fuse with the healthy cell. Then you've got maraviroc, okay, which is a CCR5 antagonist, a cellular chemokine receptor antagonist. And again, we're still outside the cell trying to get in. And if you look at the brand, you see cells entry. So sans entry means no entry. So that's one way you can think of it, that we don't want this virus to get in. Efavirenz is a non-nucleoside reverse transcriptase inhibitor. And it's paired here with N-tricitabine and tenofovir, okay, which comes to A-tripla. So the trip, I have triplet daughters, but this triple makes three drugs in one medication, and then the A surround it, so maybe against AIDS or something like that. Efavirenz is a non-nucleoside reverse transcriptase inhibitor, an NNRTI. M-tricitabine and tenofovir are nucleoside nucleotide reverse transcriptase inhibitors, or NRTIs. So a mouthful, certainly, but hopefully a good way of remembering it, that we're going from fusion and CCR5 antagonist outside the cell. Now this HIV virus is trying to attack reverse transcriptase, and then it's going to try to attack integrase, and then protease. And so by stopping reverse transcriptase, by stopping integrase, by stopping protease, we can hopefully stop the HIV. Okay. We have raltegravir, and this is Isentris. So again, we see that Sentry as one of the as the brand name, And then darunavir, which also has persista. So we're resisting the HIV virus with a protease inhibitor. Okay, so you kind of see the Tegrace, T-E-G-R, A-V-I-R in raltegravir, and in darunavir, it's really the brand name with persista that you see the protease inhibitor. But the key is that by memorizing these five brand names, and then you've certainly got the combination here, so it's eight actual medicines, but 7 actual medicines. Let me do that one again. Okay, so by memorizing HIV medications, and we have 7 medications, but five different types here, the key is that we're learning how does HIV go from this, to that. And so these orders aren't just about memorizing it, but also memorizing the pathophysiology that goes along with understanding HIV.